Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 11635 in the name of Liam Kerr on improving the performance of the Scottish education system. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Liam Kerr to speak to and move the motion around 11 minutes. Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, last week saw the publication of the Programme for International Student Assessment, or PISA, statistics. They are a four-yearly analysis of almost 700,000 15-year-old pupils across 81 countries, sitting maths, science and reading, and which are generally seen as the gold standard. The results held some deeply uncomfortable truths for Scotland, with scores in these subjects at an all-time low. Indeed, the scores have fallen since the last report in 2018 and are lower than the OECD average in maths and science. The drop from 2018 was 18 points in maths, 11 points in reading, and 7 points in science. As Professor Lindsay Patterson of Edinburgh University put it, a change of 20 points is approximately equivalent to 1 year of mid-secondary schooling. So these falls correspond to nearly a year in mathematics, over 6 months in reading, and a term in science. But crucially, this is not simply a reflection on some of the particular circumstances of the last 4 years, because what they also show is that Scotland's science score was down 14 points on 2015, significantly lower than the UK as a whole. In maths, the score has dropped 20 points since 2015 and is significantly lower than the rest of the UK. Our reading score was 33 points shy of where it stood in 2000 and is at its lowest ever level. To quote Alex Massey, 15-year-olds are producing the kinds of scores that would have been expected from 13-year-olds a generation ago. Now, some suggest, of course, that this is only one study, and it is. But remember, that's virtually all we have. Yep. As rather than address what appeared to be the early signs of falling education standards, the Scottish Government decided to withdraw from the Timms and Pearls assessments over a decade ago. And the scrapping of the Scottish Survey of Literacy and Numeracy in 2016 led this Parliament's Education Committee in 2019 to conclude the lack of baseline data means no meaningful conclusions on upward or downward trends can be reached at a time of reform within Scottish education. Now, whilst I welcome the re-entry of Scotland to Pearls and Timms, that data won't be available until 2026. 20 years on from the previous measurements, which is a problem, as it is trite that what gets measured gets fixed. Yep. And even absent those measurements, we as a Parliament surely have a duty to try and come up with solutions. And I look forward to colleagues across the chamber setting out what they feel are the underlying issues and their solutions. Yes.
Kate Forbes.
I agree with the member that what is measured matters. Does he therefore accept that statistics like PISA, whilst important, have very limited provision in terms of helping us to understand the Scottish education system?
Liam Kerr.
No, I simply can't accept that, because what we're measuring here, Kate Forbes, is maths, science and reading. And we can measure the trends over a very long time. And in fact, what they are showing is some extremely worrying trends that we all have a duty to address. And let's be absolutely clear about this, Presiding Officer. This is not the fault of our young people, who, like everywhere, have had to deal with challenges in the last few years that are unprecedented. Nor is it a failure of our teachers and their staff, who continue to do absolutely everything to deliver in a context which is far from ideal. As the Courier put it, this report is a damning indictment of the failure of successive education secretaries to get to grips with their most important task, ensuring every child in Scotland gets the best possible education for them. Such as John Swinney, who apparently dare not even come to the chamber today, like Fiona Hislop, Angela Constance or Shirley-Ann Somerville, who succeeded him, telling this chamber without evidence in 2021 that he has cautious optimism that standards are improving shortly before abandoning the Education Bill, of course, and culminating, most egregiously, in the Scottish Government's press release last week in response to the PISA figures showing Scotland's worst ever performance in science, reading and maths, that Scottish education maintains international standing. Now, I listened very carefully to the Education Secretary's statement yesterday, and I was actually encouraged by much of the tone and the acknowledgement that after previous failures, it finally sounded like we have a Cabinet Secretary who will take responsibility, which is why I was rather surprised and disappointed and will not vote for the amendment in her name today. Because rather than acknowledge and deal with PISA, as she seemed ready to do yesterday, her amendment today suggests that yesterday's figures trump PISA, a stance which Professor Lindsay Patterson claimed would be either disingenuous or evidence of dismaying statistical ignorance. So this starts with acknowledging the issues, not seeking to slopey shoulder blame, and to take responsibility for the solutions. To address issues such as the epidemic of violence, ill discipline and poor behaviour, which was also revealed by the PISA results. They showed Scotland has more frequently bullied students and our young people are twice as likely to witness a fight at school than the OECD average. In that context, the behaviour in Scottish Schools report last month was clear. A perceived lack of consequences for pupils who frequently engage in disruptive behaviour leaves educators unsupported. Yep. Presiding Officer, by failing to teach those who are perpetrating this behaviour that life has consequences, by suggesting that abuse and violence do not lead to sanctions, we fail them as much as we fail the victims. Whether those victims are teachers going off sick, or pupils absenting themselves from school after being disrespected or verbally or physically assaulted. And that means boundaries and genuine consequences for perpetrators. Perhaps, as some commentators suggest, immediate removal from the classroom with proper resource put towards educational psychologists and the like to work with the perpetrator to see if they can be returned and helped to learn, and ensuring that the teacher and the other children can also learn. Not the extraordinary policy of Fife Council seemed to have adopted just last month, part of which states that school bullies should not experience negative consequences or punishment due to their behaviour. Presiding Officer, it means looking again at what is happening with Curriculum for Excellence and addressing why, as the University of Stirling has found, since 2013 and its introduction, there has been a decrease in the number of subjects studied and entered into by fourth-year pupils, and looking at genuine vocational studies, so those whose skills and talents lie elsewhere than the academic route are properly catered for, none of which is news. Because in 2021, Shirley-Ann Somerville said, 10 years on from Curriculum for Excellence being introduced, it is right and proper that we review how it's been implemented. We accept in full all 12 recommendations from the OECD, albeit it remains somewhat questionable how many have been achieved, and perhaps the Cabinet Secretary will assist later.
I'm very grateful to Liam Kerr to give way on that point. And does he still agree with that conclusion the OECD reached in 2021, that Curriculum for Excellence was the right approach, but the failing has been in the implementation from those at the top of the pyramid about the Curriculum for Excellence for those who are at, quote, the chalk face?
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. Yes, we do. The principle of Curriculum for Excellence, I think the Chamber is on board with. It's the implementation, particularly under this government, that has been found all too wanting. And, Presiding Officer, as well it means looking at the teacher numbers. There are over 1,500 fewer secondary school teachers compared to when the SNP came to power, and 350 fewer primary school teachers than last year. Statistics released yesterday show the number of teachers still teaching after their teacher induction scheme is lower than every other year since 2017. And almost 5,000 of those who do go on to teach are on temporary contracts, fuelling job insecurity and lowered morale. And this in a context where the preference waiver payment is failing, with fewer than 7% agreeing to be sent anywhere in Scotland, leading to the teacher shortages I am constantly hearing about in places such as the North East. And meanwhile, in the midst of rocketing numbers of pupils reporting additional support needs, there's been a decline of 700 support for learning teachers. And all that in a context in which, despite a promise to cut class sizes in P1 to 3 to 18 or fewer, class sizes, as we learned yesterday, remain just over 23 on average. which is why it's disappointing the Liberal Democrat amendment was not accepted today. Yes.
Rachel Hamilton.
I'm hearing from teachers who say that the incidences of classroom violence are actually driving them out of the education system, and that is why we are losing so many really, really high-quality, valued teachers, and this government is just not supporting them.
Liam Kerr.
Well, I think that's right. I'm grateful for the contribution. That's certainly what I'm hearing, and I'm sure actually what everyone across the chamber is hearing. And a final quick point, Presiding Officer, perhaps the Cabinet Secretary will elaborate in closing on why the reform of Education Scotland, an agency which, according to a recent annual report, costs over £30 million a year to run, remains outstanding. This cannot wait, given that last summer Scottish Conservative research found that over 1,000 schools in Scotland have not been inspected in the last 10 years. That's 44% of them. So I do want to hear in the Cabinet Secretary's response her thoughts on what to do about matters such as these and our own proposals to give headteachers more powers and budgetary autonomy, to deliver a new deal for teachers by cutting red tape and unnecessary bureaucracy, and ensure that we have a curriculum focused on the development of digital skills, subject-specific knowledge, and adult education and apprenticeships in the workplace. Presiding Officer, 16 years of SNP decline shall not be undone in the 2.5 years left that we have to endure of this government. This is bigger than party politics, and we all have a responsibility, whether currently the opposition or whether the government, to acknowledge what the data is showing us, to take responsibility and ownership of uncomfortable truths, not to seek scapegoats in our young people, our teachers, our local authorities for a lack of action at government level, and to confront difficult realities. Because ultimately, the future of Scotland's economy, our NHS, our justice system, and above all, our kids' futures depend on the actions we take now. And that's why I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I now call on Jenny Gilruth to speak to and move Amendment 11635.3. Cabinet Secretary, around 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to the Conservatives for bringing forward this afternoon's debate on Scottish education. There have been a number of updates to Parliament in recent weeks, and when we return following recess, there will be, subject to parliamentary approval, fuller time to debate proposals relating to qualifications reform. Now, as I stated yesterday, post-pandemic Scottish education is at a juncture. There is much, though, to be positive about in Scottish education, but I recognise the need for improvement. It is in that spirit that I will engage with today's debate, and I will be listening to any tangible solutions from the opposition, or indeed my own party, to that end. To Mr Kerr's point, this is bigger than party politics. Presiding Officer, I spoke yesterday about this year's impressive set of Achievement of Curriculum for Excellence Levels data, also known as ACEL. That is the most comprehensive and up-to-date national picture that we currently have of young people's attainment in literacy and numeracy. Now, the ACEL data shows that for both literacy and numeracy, the proportions of primary school children achieving the expected CFE levels are at record highs for children from both the most and least disadvantaged areas of Scotland. The attainment gap in literacy in primary schools is the lowest level on record, and we're also seeing the gap reduced in secondary schools. And I want again to pay tribute to our young people and to their teachers on achieving these results. I know it's been a really difficult time for all of them since the pandemic, which I think makes this data all the more impressive. And whilst I would hope that everyone in this chamber can welcome that progress, I have seen some commentary questioning the ACEL data, because, of course, it is predicated on teachers' professional judgment. Now, I wholeheartedly reject that view. It is, I think, an insult to the teaching profession. Scotland's teachers are skilled and trained professionals. The judgments they make should be trusted, much in the same way that every year we trust our teachers to set, mark and agree the national standard in our final examination system. Happy to give way to the member.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Jenny Gilruth to give way on that point. The Cabinet Secretary is right to trust our teachers. They are graduate professionals who know their job and, more importantly, know their children who they teach. Can the Cabinet Secretary explain why she was unable to mention the PISA results in the proposed amendment, which may have made it easier to come to a consensus across this
Cabinet
chamber?
Secretary.
I'm going to come to mentioning the PISA results, which I spoke to yesterday, of course, in my update to Parliament. And I do think the PISA results are important in giving that whole picture in relation to progress within the education system. all I'm doing at the current time, presiding officer, is putting on record the results that published yesterday, which I think are welcome in terms of some of the trajectory. I'm more than happy to give way to the member, presiding officer.
Liz Smith.
Just a very quick question. What is the reason for the considerable gap between the PISA results and the ASEL results? Why is that?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think there are two different data sets. Of course, the ASEL results are predicated on teacher judgment. The PISA results are predicated on survey data. And that actually means, if you speak and engage with the OECD, as I have done, that it's very difficult to draw comparisons across countries in terms of the way that you might use the ASEL data. So there are different data sets, and I don't think it's possible for us to look at each and draw comparisons. But I do think, in the totality, it's important we have a wider data set. That's why, of course, the government has committed to rejoining TIMSS and PIRLS, and it was good to hear the member welcome that news in his contribution. It's also worth saying, presiding officer, that the ASEL data set are official statistics. They've been produced in accordance with the professional standards that are set out in the Code of Practice for Statistics. Now, presiding officer, one of the key findings from the recent PISA data that the member alluded to has been the increase in the numbers of pupils with an identified additional support need. And as I mentioned in the chamber yesterday, whilst that figure now nationally is nearly 40% in some of our schools, like the one I visited on Monday, it's nearer actually 50%. And now the PISA data gives the government an opportunity, I think, to recast how we support this cohort of young people. It does go without saying, however, that pupils with additional support needs achievements should be recognised. Indeed, 75% of those in the 21-22 cohort with an additional support need left school with one pass or more at SEQF level 5 or better. And in the same cohort, I'd like to make some progress if the member doesn't mind. In the same cohort, 93% left school with one or more qualification at SEQF 4. And additionally, the latest figures from 21-22 show spend on additional support for learning by authorities has reached a record high. We have also invested an additional £15 million since 2019-20 to increase the provision of support staff in Scotland. And I heard the member's challenge in relation to additional support needs teachers, but it's worthwhile saying that that investment has led to over 1,000 additional support staff across Scotland, bringing the total number to 16,606, a record high. Now, that investment, of course, is reflected in young people's outcomes, and I mentioned some of the progress we've seen in relation to young people with additional support needs and their outcomes. Now, the Conservative motion notes that the PISA report highlights challenges facing the education system. And both the First Minister and I have accepted that the PISA results are not good enough. But there is an assertion in the motion that Scotland's positions in mathematics and science have dropped below the OECD average. Presiding officer, that is not accurate. Scotland's PISA results remained, based on the 2022 survey results, similar to the OECD average for both maths and science. For reading, Scotland actually performs above the OECD average. Now, I accept that since the last round of PISA, Scotland has seen a reduction in PISA scores, and we need to see improvements. But let us be accurate about what PISA is actually telling us and what it is not telling us. We also need to take that holistic view of educational performance in the round. Happy to do so. Presiding officer, can I check? Is there time in hand?
I can give you a little bit of time back. Yeah. Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. Surely what PISA is telling us is not that in the last few years Scotland has somehow flatlined. It's saying that over a considerable period there has been a significant decline, long-term decline, under this SNP government.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his intervention. What I'm reiterating and what I have stated previously is that our results remain, based on the 2022 survey results, similar to the OECD average in maths and science. He will accept, well, he seems to believe from his hand gestures that Scotland is a unique country in respect of our results. We are not unique by any stretch of the imagination. In fact, the OECD, the independent OECD, call these results the COVID edition. COVID has impacted on the outcomes for our young people. I hope the member understands that. That's not unique to the Scottish system. I'd like to make some progress, and I believe I have no time in hand, presiding officer.
I give you 9 minutes. I can probably give you 10 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, presiding officer. On Monday, the Cabinet visited Haddington for a public meeting, and as George Adam observed following the meeting, the best questions the Cabinet received and the most challenging came from the school pupils in the audience, whether that was on global warming or on asylum, they raise the big issues of the day. And I think that speaks to a difference that we've already seen recorded by PISA as recently as 2018 in its assessment of global competence, where Scotland was one of the top performing countries. This important PISA study assessed young people's ability to examine local, global and intercultural issues, including sustainability, and interact effectively with people from different cultures. Presiding Officer, I'm conscious of time. I want to touch briefly on some of the progress that we have been able to make since the pandemic. The ASIL data previously mentioned is supplemented, of course, by our examination system, where the overall pass rates at National 5 higher and advanced higher this year were above the 2019 pre-pandemic levels. And the attainment gap during that time, since the pandemic, has narrowed. But of course I accept that not everything is perfect, which is why we must commit to redouble our efforts to secure better improvements in the Scottish education system to deliver better outcomes for our children and young people. Now, we're already responding to PISA in a robust and comprehensive way, focusing on maths and curriculum improvement, where we are taking a range of steps, which I set out in detail in the Chamber yesterday. And I've also committed to expanding the range of objective data that we have available to us, as Mr Kerr alluded to in relation to rejoining a number of international surveys. And Presiding Officer, part of Scotland's improvement journey has to be about our education reform programme, which I think is going to help drive the measures we need to see to improve outcomes. And as part of this, reform of our national education bodies will deliver change in practice and in culture. Mr Kerr mentioned, of course, the role of the inspectorate, and the interim chief inspector was recently appointed, actually, and she will play a pivotal role in providing that critical leadership required to deliver the change that is needed. But I'm also ensuring that the voices of teachers and those with a stake in the education system are heard at every opportunity. That's why there's been ongoing consultation and engagement in the new qualifications body and ways to maximise the positive impact that I think reform can deliver. And it's also, Presiding Officer, why I'm committed to designing a new centre for teaching excellence with teachers, professional associations and other stakeholders. And I'm grateful to the Council of Deans, who I met with earlier today, to talk to some of their work to support that venture. Presiding Officer, there is a lot to be positive about in Scottish education, although I accept there is work to be done to secure improvements. For my part, I'm focused on those improvements, and I set out some of those in the Chamber yesterday. I don't shy from the challenge, and the implicit opportunity must not be missed. But in that same spirit, the opposition can't shy away from where there are real positives in Scottish education. Record attainment levels in primary, a record low attainment gap in literacy and in primary schools, exam pass rates above the pre-pandemic level, and the highest investment per pupil and the lowest pupil-teacher ratio in the UK. But in the rush to attack the government, which I accept is part and parcel of the approach to politics, the opposition are also dismissive of some of the achievements of our pupils, teachers and support staff. So I ask them today to engage with the substance of the data rather than the politics. And if they do so in me, they will have a willing partner. And in that spirit, I move the amendment in my name, which sets out the facts and accepts that there is a need for improvement. I hope members across the chamber will be able to support it. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call Pam Duncan-Glancy to speak to and move Amendment 11635.1 around 7 minutes. Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. I welcome this debate today because it comes at a time when I think there is consensus on education that enough is enough. In the last week, a range of statistics have laid bare this government's 16 years of inaction and broken promises in education, that it has ultimately let children down, left teachers exhausted and allowed too many pupils to fall through the cracks. PISA data reported that Scotland's once world-leading education system has declined in international rankings and the attainment gap has grown. Summary data on Scottish schools revealed concerns around teacher numbers, pupil attendance and behaviour. And ASIL data showed pupils with additional support needs continue to be more likely to miss important milestones at every stage of their school career. It shouldn't have taken it to get this bad or taken this long before the government acknowledged the scale of the problem. Teachers, parents, pupils and queues of experts have been sounding alarm bells for years. But instead of listening, the government has long grasped concerns by setting up groups and reviews and removed us from international studies that could have given us the vital signs of the path we were on and that have ultimately camouflaged the decline. I was pleased, though, to detect a bit of a change yesterday from the Cabinet Secretary in her statement, as she finally appeared to grasp the gravity of the situation. And I do look forward to hearing more detail on those proposals. This really was a welcome change, but for those thousands of children who started school as the SNP took office, I think it could be too little too late. The failure to address the long-standing systemic problems in the education system in Scotland that has got us where we are means the problems faced are numerous. The solutions must therefore be two. And I hope that the recognition we saw yesterday develops beyond vague statements, because it is vital that we reverse the decline, and much of that includes some of the issues that are outlined in today's motion. Presiding officer, class sizes are getting bigger, support staff numbers are dropping, and attendance rates are plummeting. Teachers are being crushed under the weight of policy developed on high without their involvement. They're drowning in paperwork, struggling to find the time for lesson planning, and they're facing an exodus of their colleagues who can't bear the pressure anymore. In some areas, we have probation teachers filling vacancies because such is the scale of the recruitment and retention challenge. The SNP itself has recognised what some of the solutions could be, and in some, they've even committed to implementing them. But on so many, teachers have been left waiting, in some cases for over 15 years, and they've not just been met with a lack of delivery, but things have actually got worse. Despite committing in 2007 to reduce class sizes to 18 pupils or less, many teachers still have over 30 pupils in their classes. There are more classes with more than 18 pupils than there were back then. The pupil-teacher ratio is flatlining rather than improving. That means teachers are being stretched even more. Chronic shortage of non-contact time for teachers, another promise the SNP has failed to deliver, is compounding the challenge. And the Cabinet Secretary knows that I've raised this issue with her on a number of occasions, and that I remain disappointed that this Government has still not given a timescale as to when this will be delivered. Presiding officer, I say this to the Government, not just on this policy, but on every commitment it announces. When they make a promise, they should have already done the work to ensure they can deliver it. People understand that these issues are tricky and that they need time to sort. And of course they understand that they'll want to talk to people about it. What they don't understand is being presented with things that they assume have been thought through, only to realise they haven't, and ultimately to be let down when they're never done. So it's not fair that this government is leading teachers and pupils up a hill, leaving them there waiting for action that never ever comes. And according to the Scottish Government's own survey, more than two-thirds of teachers have had enough of it. They're all considering leaving the profession due to the overwhelming workload and lack of support. At the same time, we're seeing a fall in teacher numbers driven by a decline in primary education for the second year in a row. Presiding officer, the teachers who are there, there are fewer support staff to help them out. The Cabinet Secretary knows that earlier this year the national discussion stated that with more than a third, and actually has now said the PISA data has pointed out sometimes 40% and in some classrooms 50% children are identified as having an additional support needs. It can't be considered additional anymore, and the Cabinet Secretary has accepted that, and it was in the national discussion. But it's a fundamental feature of our education system, so I can't understand why there was no mention of that in yesterday's statement. The ASL data made it really clear that those children are less likely to reach the expected levels of reading, writing, numeracy, listening and talking at every stage. They're five times more likely to be excluded and have lower attendance rates, especially in secondary school. And to leave them off the statement, relying on proposals that were more than 3 years old is just not good enough. Then we need up-to-date, targeted, ambitious action for pupils with additional support needs, and we need progress on the Angela Morgan review. Because right now, despite the best efforts of teachers and school staff, educational inequalities are being exacerbated because the system is under so much strain, it's struggling to meet the needs of everyone, never mind of pupils who have additional support. The Curriculum for Excellence, of course, was designed and intended to deliver personalised learning. But I'm afraid to say the SNP have failed to give teachers the time, the space, the resources they need to make it happen. This government's management of our education system, and it gives me no joy to say it, is characterised by a lack of coherence, years of underinvestment, a failure to prioritise the need of children, schools being starved of resources, overcrowded classrooms, outdated facilities and a lack of qualified teachers. It can't go on anymore. And if the Cabinet Secretary and the government detect exasperation and anger in my tone, it's because I really am exasperated and angry about the situation on behalf of pupils and teachers who've been let down across Scotland. Scottish Labour believe that we have to now take the necessary steps to support teachers, invest in our schools, and that we can, if we do that, we can create a system that empowers young people to reach their potential. Have I got time?
The member's just concluding, I'm afraid.
I'm sorry, I only have half a minute left. It can't go on. We need to create a system that empowers young people to reach their potential. That means promised action on reduced class sizes, increased non-contact time, prioritised support for children with additional support needs and reversing the trend of cuts to local authorities. We have to hold the government to account on this for leaving children struggling and teachers overwhelmed, and I won't apologise for that. But where they come to the Chamber with specific actions that will make a big difference to education in Scotland, we of course will support them. With a fair and equitable and ambitious system, education can unlock the potential in every single young person in Scotland. That's the education system that Scottish Labour believe in, and that is the sort of education system that we will fight for. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Unfortunately, there isn't really any time in hand this afternoon due to the pressure of business at the back end of the afternoon, so I'm going to have to require members to stick broadly to their time limits. And with that, I call Willie Rennie up to 6 minutes, Mr Rennie.
I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, for your permission to leave the Chamber early this afternoon, but I want to apologise to colleagues as well. I have an important appointment that I must attend. We're not really debating whether the PISA results were bad, because the First Minister has already admitted that they are. They're the worst ever. Yes, the Education Secretary is right. All countries have declined since the pandemic, but Scotland has declined more than most. We're behind, and this stings, we're behind England on reading, on maths and on science. That's in the context, we must remember, that back in 2016 we were promised a dramatic closure of the poverty-related attainment gap, but also a dramatic rise in improvement in performance. In short, big improvements were promised, but instead we've had decline. And yesterday's ASO figures don't really change that analysis. And I'm disappointed with the Education Secretary when she describes them as record high. They've only been gone since 2016. This is not a great achievement to have a record high for results that are in such a short period of time. I'm sorry, I've not got enough time. I've got a lot of constructive things to say this afternoon. It's not a shock. But I was also disappointed yesterday with the government's ambition on the poverty-related attainment gap. They admitted that it's only going to be reduced by a third by 2026, when it was promised to be closed completely. Now, I think it's reasonable to say that the last set of reforms have not worked. They were always an incoherent mix with no central philosophy. The fundamental weakness, though, was that the government didn't really know what was wrong with Scottish education before it embarked on those reforms. And if you don't know what's wrong, I don't know how you can fix it. I asked Shirley Ann Somerville, the last Education Secretary, in the Education Committee last year, what she thought was wrong with education. She told me that it was the weak middle, which would be strengthened by the creation of regional improvement collaboratives. Now, they've now been ditched, so I'm not sure what the government now thinks is the problem with Scottish education. To be honest, I'm not even sure it was an answer at the time. And from today, I don't think we've really got an explanation as to what the current Education Secretary thinks is wrong with Scottish education. And it's not just the last set of reforms. We need to acknowledge that Curriculum for Excellence has not delivered on its promise. Everyone agrees with the principles, but the implementation just has not worked. I know the decline in education performance stretches back some time before Curriculum for Excellence, but the decline has accelerated since its introduction. So it does look like there's a link. Many have focused on the move from 222, the split, through to the BGE, the broad general education, and the senior phase, the two-term dash, the narrowing of subject choice in the senior phase. Now, these are all issues, but it must be something much more fundamental. And I think it's the balance between knowledge and skills. It's not one or the other. It's got to be the balance. And that's where yesterday's statement was interesting, with a specific reference to knowledge in the review of maths. It's something that Carol Ford, Keir Bloomer and Lindsay Paterson have been highlighting for some time, and I know the Education Secretary has been in discussion with them. Perhaps the dilution of knowledge, particularly in primary, could be the reason why we have struggled with our international performance. But there is also an issue with implementation. Teachers feel as if they were cut adrift. They were left to reinvent the wheel, class by class, to produce materials in some crude attempt to empower them. I would support classroom materials co-produced by teachers nationally, which teachers could adopt for application in their own class. To assist that, we need the reintroduction of subject principal teachers, so we can have subject specialist leaders across the country who can assist with that. At all stages, standards should be set for teachers to assess the attainment of pupils. I'm still not convinced about SNSAs, as they bring all the negatives that come with league tables, but none of the benefits of independent assessment. So I hope the Education Secretary will extend yesterday's change on the balance between knowledge and skills from maths to other subjects, but also looks at standards at every level and the production of materials for the class. And as we consider the reform of the Education Inspectorate, we've got to ask ourselves the question why the predecessor did not pick up the falling standards of Scottish education. Why was that not identified, and how can we make sure that is not repeated in future? Now, on behaviour, teachers, I have to say, were insulted last week with the inference that they were the problem and they required to be retrained. The £900,000 was paltry, but it was the principle of claiming, and the only tangible announcement in last week's statement was on this, that training of teachers was essential to solve the problem of violence. And I just don't accept that. We need to change the guidance on discipline so there are clear boundaries and consequences. When I was at school, there was perhaps a little bit too much punishment. So I now think, and I think the move away from that is right, and we've moved to understand more. But I do worry that we now perhaps understand a little too much. We need to look at how the nurture agenda is working so that it doesn't act as an incentive. Now, I'm supportive of the nurture agenda, but we need to make sure that we get it right. And we also need the resources and the specialist backup to make this work. We need an education secretary who's on it, and we want to support her.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. We now move to the open debate. I call first Sue Webber, who will be followed by Michelle Thompson. Ms Webber, up to 5 minutes, please.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. The headlines tell a sorry tale as the latest PISA study confirms Scotland has fallen to record low levels in maths, reading and science internationally. And the Cabinet Secretary, as Willie Rennie has just said, should not be so proud of this dismal performance. Yeah. Maths and science are lower than the OECD average. And PISA also shows attainment in maths, science and literature has risen in countries such as Japan and Korea. And two of those categories, other countries have also seen increases in attainment. For example, Singapore, Italy and Israel. Remember, COVID was global and cannot be used as an excuse for anything any longer. Education expert Professor Lindsay Patterson pointed out the results show that the decline between 2012 and 2022 is the equivalent of losing 16 months of math teaching and 8 months in reading. And the loss of 18 months in science schooling is truly shocking. It is vital for our competitiveness in an increasingly digital world. We must really, really wake up and smell the roses with this. We are falling behind. Despite this, Professor Patterson's also pointed out that since 2010 and the introduction of the Curriculum for Excellence, the attainment gap between the poorest and the wealthiest backgrounds has widened. And remember, it is after all about priorities. Closing the gap was once claimed to be the priority of the SNP and the former First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon. And the Scottish Government Behaviour in Schools report has also found that levels of disruption have increased across all of the surveyed categories. Low-level disruptive behaviour, disengagement and serious disruptive behaviours have all increased since 2016, along with a decline in most reported positive behaviours. And I, it will come as no surprise to anyone in the Chamber, want to focus a bit on mobile phones. The Scottish Government Behaviour in Schools report could not be clearer. In secondary schools, the behaviour most commonly reported is having the greatest negative impact was pupils using and looking at mobile phones or tablets when they should not be. It is said that more than half of secondary school staff said this is one of the three behaviours that had the greatest negative impact. Of course, most pupils are well behaved, but all suffer from the consequences of disruption and are vulnerable to distraction. We know mobile phones are not only the cause of growing school discipline problems, the report also cites rising incidences of drug and alcohol consumption. But if mobile phones are the significant contributor, then their removal must surely be part of the solution. Gordonstoun School has made headlines earlier this year when phones were banned, and the head teacher, Lisa Kerr, was spot on to argue, "We don't allow them unfettered access to other addictive substances, so why mobiles?" She claimed that it's lazy, irresponsible and dangerous not to place controls on young people's access to an online world which they and we simply don't fully understand and can't control. And frankly, I agree. And quietly, other schools are following suit. Here in Edinburgh, the head teacher... I'm afraid I don't have the opportunity, Mr McGregor. I'm really apologies for that. But here in Edinburgh, the head teacher at the Royal High School has taken the opportunity to strengthen their mobile device policy. Devices are not permitted to be used during the school day, and this is being strictly enforced. As a result, there has been a marked improvement in pupil engagement, with pupils taking more, talking more and being less heightened about what they are missing on their devices. Head teacher Pauline Walker says it's taken a couple of weeks for pupils to realise the school was serious, and now they are far more engaged and less anxious about what they might be missing on their phones. But no, they will be confiscated for the rest of the day if they are seen in use. One problem cited in this Behaviour in Schools report was also the perceived lack of consequences for pupils who engage in the serious disruptive behaviour. So it's essential they know that rule-breaking means trouble. Banning mobile phones in schools won't solve deep-rooted problems, but it will help. A consistent and enforced mobile phone policy restricting their use is vital if we are serious about tackling the behaviour issues in our school. And it was heartening to learn yesterday that refreshed guidance will be forthcoming to reinforce that banning mobile phones in our classrooms is an option for head teachers to use. And I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her commitment yesterday to write to me with further details on this. In closing, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Conservatives will restore excellence in our education through learning in schools, giving teachers and school staff the support they need, and every young person the chance they deserve. Yeah,
well, thank you. I now call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Michael Mara. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. No one in Scotland can be satisfied with the latest PISA ratings data. However, given long-term trends, no one amongst the developed economies can be satisfied. And in this short speech, I'll explain more. I've been impressed by some of the qualitative analysis within the PISA report and some of the external expert commentary, including from Andreas Schleicher, the highly regarded Director for Education Skills at the OECD. We should not ignore, but we must take care in interpreting some of the statistical data. As a recent article in the Financial Times put it, speaking about data for English schools, critics argue that PISA rankings give a misleading picture as the difference in performance between some countries is not statistically significant and methodological issues mean the headline scores can be overinterpreted. One serious issue is a failure. Yes, of course.
Liam Kerr.
Grateful. Andreas Schleicher also made a further point, and that was that attainment in Scotland was declining long before COVID came along. Does the member recognise that, and does she agree with that?
Michelle Thompson.
It does. It goes back to the point that, from the Labour front branch there, with which I agreed. One serious issue is a failure of many advanced economies to meet sampling standards, and the UK is actually amongst some of the worst. So we cannot over-rely on the broad statistical data and have to look at the qualitative analysis of long-term trends. A lack of understanding these wider trends and more in-depth analysis is what's missing in the Tory motion, which frankly just seeks superficial headlines. There's been a long-term trend... across advanced economies of a decline in educational performances measured by PISA. And as Andrea Schleicher points out, COVID wasn't the only cause of the decline in standards in advanced Western economies. He argues that one striking trend over the past decade has been a constant deterioration of average reading and science scores in the OECD. The developed world no longer has a monopoly over good education. The world is no longer divided between rich and well-educated countries and poor and badly educated countries. So then what can we learn, which I think surely is the point of this debate, both from the decline in developed countries and the high performance in countries such as in East Asia? Finland, once thought as having a particularly successful education system, is a case in point. Its learning loss since 2018 was almost three times the OECD average in reading and four times higher in science. Schleicher argues this is because Finland has relaxed its academic expectations for students. It's also argued that there's been a trend in the wealthy countries towards commodifying education, where pupils and students become consumers and teachers become service providers, one thing we ferociously resisted in Scotland. In contrast, successful Asian countries are geared around high expectations and strong social relationships between teachers and students. In other words, a key issue is the culture that surrounds and informs the education experience. During a debate in my early days as a member of this Parliament, I argued that our college sector, following the Cumberford-Little report, should strive for excellence rather than competence. I think we need to assess whether we have a sufficient focus on excellence in the wider education sector too. Again, quoting Schleicher, he argues that the lesson is that we have to achieve student well-being not at the expense of academic success, but through academic success. I do acknowledge that COVID has had a significant effect. Truancy rates across the UK have increased, as is the case in many other countries coming out of COVID restrictions. Countries that imposed shorter lockdowns were more likely to have relatively higher attainment. Education systems were also more resilient, where children had the skills to learn autonomously and where pupils felt more supported by their teachers. Finally, Presiding Officer, I want to raise a COVID-related issue, not from PISA, but as a result of observations from our own professional speech and language therapists in Scotland. Glenn Carter, the head of the Royal College of Speech and Language Therapy Scotland, in an important report in January of this year, stated that we are facing a spoken language crisis in Scotland. If no action is taken, these issues will have a significant impact on children's mental health, learning and future life choices. There's been a 20% increase in the number of young children needing communication support in Scotland. Starting school with weak language skills makes early years education extraordinarily difficult. If we don't act, it will increase the attainment gap. So we do need to find ways to better support pupils and teachers in tackling this language crisis, which is partly caused by the pandemic. And I would welcome comments on this particular point from the Minister or Cabinet Secretary. I've only scratched the surface of the qualitative challenges we face. And I do hope going forward that this is an area where the Education Committee can play its part in making a contribution in learning lessons for the future of Scottish education. I certainly intend to play my part. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Thompson. I now call Michael Manna to be followed by Ben McPherson. Up to 6 minutes, Mr Manna.
Presiding Officer, the PISA statistics published last week were a gut punch and have rightly generated anger across the country. And they should serve as a wake-up call to this government. But I have to ask, Presiding Officer, how many such wake-up calls do there need to be? So the contribution so far, I have to say, in my view, reek of complacency and denial, a listless torpor of a government, frankly, that's out on its feet, out of ideas and increasingly out of time. The Cabinet Secretary is keen to emphasise that this is the special COVID edition of these PISA figures. She is less keen on observing that the outcome is a decline across the entirety of the 16 years of this government, which they have done nothing to check and, frankly, have only served to accelerate. On the impact of COVID, the decline in Scottish performance post-pandemic has been worse than in economically comparable countries across the OECD. And it's little wonder, Presiding Officer, given the risible nature of the Education Recovery Plan that was published in October 2021, which amounted to a series of re-announcements of previous projects and an aspiration to put back in place just some of the teachers that they had already cut. There was no concerted action to help those groups that were most impacted from the pandemic, and that shows in these figures. Frankly, they never even got round to cutting off the bottom of the doors. Our nation is at an all-time low in maths and science, and our joint lowest level in reading in the history of these figures. Urgent action is needed to arrest the long-term decline which this SNP government has presided over. And I listened with some dismay yesterday when the Cabinet Secretary was cautioning that this data should not be read in isolation, something that we're hearing again twice now from the backbenches of SNP members. I certainly hope that PISA does not become the new JERS figures for the SNP, methodological quibbles, internet conspiracy theories and rampant whataboutery. Because last month, the IFS warned that Scotland had experienced the largest decline in maths of the UK nations. In 2006, it was the best performing of all the UK nations. So what of those other wake-up calls that I referred to, Presiding Officer? Let's give you just a small selection of some of them. 2015, the OECD Perspective on CFE report. In 2018, research from Professor Jim Scott was damning on the variation in the curriculum structure across Scotland. Also in 2018, research from Professors Priestley and Shapira on the narrowing of the curriculum. Their further work in 2023 showing dramatic reduction in subjects taken in S4 under CFE across Scotland. 2018 also, a key year, not at this moment, but 2018 also, Professor Lindsay Patterson writing for the London School of Economics. No baseline data was ever collected to allow us to trace curriculum impact. 2019, the Parliament's own Education Committee, the damning report on the implementation of CFE and the narrowing of curriculum and the failures in transitions, certainly.
Michelle Thompson.
I've listened with interest to his all highly selective quotes and statistics. I'm wondering if at any point in his speech he's going to come up with positive measures to start to address some of the complexity in the situation, or is he just going to moan?
Michael Mara.
I think it's fair to say that the current situation is well worth a moan, Ms Thompson. And I think that there's a whole variety of issues that we have brought to this chamber over recent years, talking about the necessary reforms in education they've completely neglected to undertake. Because only in June of this year, there was a report on the national discussion in Scottish education. It was brutal on the structure and the operation of CFE. In 2021, the OECD report, it was published after the SQA scandal that they presided over, where the SNP ministers cut the grades of the poorest kids in Scotland. That led then directly to Professor Ken Muir being commissioned to report on the reform of the SQA in Education Scotland, something that we were happy to support, Ms Thompson, in terms of positive measures to reform education in Scotland. And there were warm words from the Education Secretary at the time, but none of it ever happened. The SQA never scrapped. Education Scotland never reformed. Despite Shirley Ann Somerville's assertion she wanted to progress at pace, would you ever believe it, that they would have operating models for new bodies in place by the end of this year. That year was 2022. We're at the end of 2023. Nothing done. Nothing done at all. Professor Muir must wonder why he ever bothered at all. Professor Louise Hayward then was gone forward with more of her recommendations and the work that she did further delayed by this Cabinet Secretary. So why embark on serious, challenging work when you could have another working group, another consultation, another statement, another discussion? Perhaps the people of Scotland won't notice their government is not really doing anything at all. Because I used to warn about the glacial pace of education reform, Presiding Officer. Frankly, it slowed to an absolute standstill. This is the hard work of genuine transformative reform that could set our education system back on track, but it's filed under too difficult by a government only interested in political stunts, easy wins and giveaways. And we are past the point, I am afraid, where this Cabinet Secretary can garner any sympathy for being the latest one in the door, having to clean up the mess of our predecessors. And she is getting on with this work, scrapping the regional improvement collaboratives, which were the defining education achievement of John Swinney's calamitous tenure as Education Secretary. Maybe she might look at Shirley Ann Somerville's decision
to slash poverty attainment funding for the most impoverished communities in Scotland. And let's remember that 8 years ago, Nicola Sturgeon said she wanted to be judged on all of this, calling it her defining mission. God forbid that anything else that the people of Scotland care about should be subject to the same missionary zeal when whatever matters to them most comes under the focus of this government.
Thank you. I now call Ben McPherson to be followed by Brian Whittle. Up to 6 minutes, Mr McPherson.
Signing off, sir. This is a really serious debate today, and as a member of the Education Committee, and generally, I'm pleased to take part in it. Firstly, I think it's important to acknowledge there's much to be positive about in terms of Scottish education. We have the lowest pupil-teacher ratio, the highest spend per pupil, and the best paid teachers in the United Kingdom. Higher education is more affordable, as is further education, and this year's exam results have shown continued progress in closing the poverty-related attainment gap. However, there are big challenges, and we need to work to continually improve. That we must acknowledge. And as we move forward, we would serve our constituents better if we are constructive and we work together and put our young people first. As some colleagues know, I used to work in a school in the office, and I did so during the academic year of 2009 and 2010. I think of those times often to help me in this role, put myself in the shoes, so to speak, of staff and pupils. And I think of the context that we're in since that time, when Curriculum for Excellence was being implemented. I think of the consequences of the financial crash, the years of Conservative and Lib Dem austerity, the welfare reform that took place during that period, the negativity of Brexit and the disruption that caused, and of course, the pandemic. During that period, we have seen context in which society has been under severe challenge. And in that period, not only have we seen initiatives from the Scottish Government directly to intervene to improve our education system and to help our young people, but also in the space of equality and social justice, whether that's the Scottish Child Payment lifting around 90,000 children out of poverty, or the pupil equity funding that I know in my constituency makes a really significant and important difference. And I would say to some opposition members, while of course you should hold the Scottish Government to account, you would serve your constituents better if you also put pressure on your colleagues at Westminster who hold the power when it comes to so much of the social security system. All of those challenges were, of course, exacerbated by the pandemic. It is right that we need to move beyond the pandemic and that we must not use it as an excuse. But the PISA results, while important and demonstrate the need for improvement, do factually reflect the cohort of young people who experienced unprecedented disruption to their education because of school closures during the pandemic and the behavioural changes that are affecting schools up and down the UK and beyond, and across the majority of the countries participating in PISA. That is why all across all three countries in the UK, reading, maths and science saw reductions in its scores. Now, I appreciate the particular challenge for Scotland. We must take that seriously. But also, we haven't seen declines in our young people in Scotland going on to further and higher education. So we need to also keep in mind that there are positive destinations that the vast majority, as far as I can recall, around 94% of our young people are going on to positive destinations. The PISA report outlines that for Scotland and for many other comparable European countries, this is also a crucial time for reform, and colleagues have been right to raise that. To achieve the changes we want to see, we must move on from political knockabout and the language of league tables, and into a serious and collective sense of determination to reform our system, to recognise the wide array of skills and achievements of our young people, and to meet the challenges of the 21st century. Reforms I would like to see, and these we have considered at committee, are how do we move to a position where we are not teaching to the test to the same way, but also achieving consistency? That is really difficult. How do we improve our primary education system, as Willie Rennie emphasised? How do we improve the situation for those with additional support needs, as Pam Duncan-Glancy was right to point out? How do we embrace new technologies, as Michelle Thompson emphasised? And how do we enhance our teacher training and continue professional development? And I would like to, at this point, quote Professor Muir, who wisely said, "As a system, we genuinely need to learn lessons from the introduction of Curriculum for Excellence. It is questionable how successful we were in doing that. Professional learning and engagement of all staff and the philosophy of any reform or change is critical. It is about learning lessons from where we did not get it right in introducing Curriculum for Excellence, didn't get it quite right. And it's about sharing the philosophy, developing the understanding, and critically ensuring that teacher education programmes in Scotland and the continuing professional development that teachers require are provided upfront as part of the reform process." And that also requires reform in here about how we discuss this issue. And again, I would quote from committee Professor Humes, who said, "I want a much more hard-headed kind of political discourse in which things are described as they are and ideas are engaged with at a proper intellectual level. It is not all about promotion, advertising and getting the headline in tomorrow's press." And that applies to all political parties in this chamber. Education is important. It should be about real issues, real aspirations and realistic aspirations that are not overhyped or boasted about. Let's rise to that challenge in our political discourse and also in how we reform our education system, listening to experts and working together.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. I now call Brian Whittle to be followed by John Mason. Up to 5 minutes, Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The only true advantage we have is to learn faster than our competitors. That is a quote it was used by a good friend of mine, Frank Dick, who is the Director of Coaching of British Athletics and now one of the most revered sports and business coaches in the world. What that means, Deputy Presiding Officer, in that an increasingly competitive world in which we live, it's not enough to improve if those we are in competition with improve faster. The net result is we still fall further behind. And that's what PISA results starkly highlight. Now, I listened to the Cabinet Secretary yesterday in a statement to Parliament, and COVID reared its ugly head again. That catch-all for everything bad that's happening across Scottish Government portfolios. However, Deputy Presiding Officer, the inconvenient truth for the Cabinet Secretary and for the Scottish Government is that COVID was a pandemic, and it affected the whole world, and the Scottish Government managed to oversee a much faster drop in PISA numbers than anywhere else in the United Kingdom. Yeah. Despite the Cabinet Secretary's claim to have greater teacher-pupil ratio than the rest of the United Kingdom, outcomes, Deputy Presiding Officer, not the strongest suit of this government. In fact, it should be noted that the sharpest relative drop in PISA rankings in Scotland happened between 2012 and 2015. Try linking that to COVID. Education is the cornerstone of every portfolio, and solutions to just about every challenge facing a country are rooted in a flourishing education system that gives pupils every opportunity to develop their talents and be all they can be. Get education wrong, and every portfolio suffers. Unfortunately, we have a Scottish Government who are only interested in headlines irrespective of outcomes. And look at health, where education has such a pivotal role. They will tell us that the Scottish Government are put... of course, I'll take it.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Brian Whittle give way, and I apologise for interrupting me in the sentence. He talks about education being the cornerstone to every portfolio, which I absolutely agree with. But education is not the cause of failings in every portfolio, which seems to be pointed at by some people.
Frank. He's absolutely correct, but it is the solution. That's the point here. And in health, the Scottish Government are telling us that they have record levels of investment into our health service. More nurses and doctors than anywhere else in the United Kingdom. Yet the outcomes tell us we are the unhealthiest nation in Europe. Mm-hmm. And in the economy that continues to underperform, our poor health record is the biggest drag. Highest levels of economically inactive, highest levels of disability unemployment. Deputy Presiding Officer, education is so much more than maths and English and physics and chemistry. It's about developing our youth to be confident, resilient, aspirational risk-takers and innovators that Scotland has such a world reputation for. What the current Cabinet Secretary and her predecessors seem to have a complete blind spot to is the solution that our schools desperately need. It's not more academic classes, but a complete change in the learning environment. We need to tackle poor physical and mental health, poor behaviour, attainment and poor nutrition. We need to unshackle our teachers to allow them to do the job they love and what they are trained to do. By directly looking at these solutions, the answers to the current performance slide could be addressed. It's about creating an inclusive and active environment to feed that thirst for knowledge that youth should have, embedding the huge opportunities that the green economy brings and enthusing our pupils that Scotland is a place to stay where the brightest of futures is there for them to grasp. The decline in PISA reflects a decline in physical activity, in music and art and drama, and much of the extracurricular activity once enjoyed by school pupils. These activities draw in active minds, they give an outlet for enthusiasm, they deliver aspiration, self-discipline and an appreciation of application. They help to create an environment where learning is varied and exciting. The Scottish Government's response to PISA results was to try and persuade us that Scotland had maintained its international standing, when quite clearly they are managing its sharp decline. Curriculum for Excellence was voted in by this Parliament from across this chamber, but is in the implementation the Scottish Government once again fail. Innovation is something we should all get behind, but in doing so, we have to be prepared to accept if it's not gaining the results planned for, be prepared to listen and adapt. Not getting everything right the first time is not a crime, but not getting it right and continuing to plough the same furrow with our head in the sand is criminal. Ignoring all the warnings from across agencies, teachers and this Parliament with their usual massaging of figures and nothing to see here attitude typifies a Scottish Government who placed little stock on outcome rather than headlines. Deputy Presiding Officer, in closing, education should be something that brings this Parliament together. Failing to get education right has such a profound impact across all of society, and Scottish society is having to live with the reality of an SNP failure to grasp the enormity of the problem that it's created. Judge me on our education, said Nicola Sturgeon. It's just a pity that Scotland has to wait more than 2 years to get rid of this government and start the process of rebuilding our once-envied education reputation. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. I now call John Mason to be followed by Jamie Green. Up to 6 minutes, Mr Mason.
Thank you very much, and I'm pleased to speak in today's debate. Education is clearly a hugely important subject, so it's good that the Conservatives have brought forward this debate today. Now, one of my colleagues, who shall remain nameless but sits on the front bench, it was mocking me yesterday as I had mentioned something of what school was like in the 1960s and 1970s when I was there. But perhaps it is worth remembering some of the changes since then. Class numbers were well over 30, not unusual. I and many others lived in fear of our teachers. We spent hours and hours on spelling correctly. Memorising times tables was an absolute key. And we got belted if we could not answer questions from the homework we were meant to have done. So I think most of us would agree that there have been improvements in all of these factors since then. When I go into schools in the constituency nowadays, there seems to be a much healthier relationship between pupils and staff, and I think our schools are turning out much more rounded individuals than they did in the past. Yes, briefly.
Mr. Mason, of course, was a pupil at Hutchison's Grammar School. As were Mr. Sarwar and Mr. Yusuf. Does he think they are more rounded individuals as a consequence of their more modern education at that school than he was from his time there, being bullied and blutered as he's just outlined?
John Mason.
Well, I would say I don't think my school days were the happiest days of my life, if that answers his point. But I would accept that spelling and grammar has deteriorated. When I take on a younger member of staff, sometimes their spelling and grammar can be pretty grim. But then again, so it is in the newspapers I read and on the BBC. Now, last Christmas, I was given a book called Bad Data by Georgina Sturge from the House of Commons Library, and it really is an excellent read. One of the messages is not to believe all that politicians tell you when they quote data or when they make comparisons with data, either between jurisdictions or over time. So when we look at the PISA figures or any other analysis, I do think we always need to be asking ourselves, are we really comparing like with like? Are we sure that this is an objective comparison, or is it to some extent skewed by other factors? Very briefly.
I appreciate the member giving way. Does he not recognise that there has been a litany of reports over many years regarding identifying just many of the failures that are pointed out through these statistics? And that is the context that we have to see it in, and we need the genuine reform that they recommend.
John Mason.
I think we need to take all of the factors into account, but I think we have to compare like with like. And I think comparing a Scottish curriculum or lack of it with a very tight English curriculum is not a fair comparison. There was a good article in PISA in the Herald last week by James McEnany. He started off with a quote, a lot of the response has been to PISA has been characterised by panic, puffed up rhetoric and a somewhat tenuous relationship with the concept of accuracy. That is fair enough. He goes on to point out that Scotland's declining PISA performance was a feature prior to the first election of the SNP. Then he notes that at international level, there has been a widespread decline in the performance of 15-year-olds. Specifically, he points to Germany, which improved dramatically between 2000 and 2012, up 24 points in reading and maths, up 37 points in science. But now Germany is back to 4 points lower than it was in 2000. He does not argue that the data itself is a problem, but rather that the application of the data can be. Now, the Conservative motion is certainly wide-ranging and covers a lot of ground. It says that solutions should be explored, without being very specific as to what these solutions should be, although it does propose re-entering all statistical comparisons and benchmarks. But as has been said by others, measuring a problem does not solve it. Weighing the pig or comparing it to other pigs does not fatten it. And some of the language in the Conservative motion is a bit over the top. Demands that the Scottish Government uses its powers, implementation of curriculum for excellence has failed, calls for a fundamental rethink, all a bit black and white. Yes, I accept that there is room for improvement, but let's not throw out the baby with the bathwater. Now, of course, class sizes and support numbers are important factors, but let's also remember we are in tight financial times, and we have to choose priorities amongst all we would like to do in next week's budget. Is the NHS the priority, or is it the hospitality sector, or is it education? And if it's education, is it schools, or is it colleges? Or are we going to support all of these sectors, in which case it will be to a limited extent? But one thing is certain, we cannot do all we would want to do within the budget, and especially with Westminster cutting NIC and giving companies corporation tax breaks, there is less money both in the UK and in Scotland for public services. We should remember too that the numbers of young people going to positive destinations is really high at 94.3%. That seems to me to be a key measure. Of course, we want these destinations to improve over time, a higher level of training, a better job, and so on. But we have debated here before, and I think we agreed that university is not the right destination for everyone. There is a right path for each individual young person. Parental involvement is another key, and I know that some schools have been using PEF money to strengthen these relationships. I remember a head teacher told me it was like having two schools under the one roof. One set of pupils who had parental encouragement and support, and another set of pupils who did not. And it is clear that some of our families from ethnic minority backgrounds have a huge commitment to education, both the parents and the children, and they are doing very well, even in poorer areas. With the best will in the world, I do not believe that schools can make up for all the issues that there may be in the home. So in conclusion, I think we need a bit of balance in all this. Yes, the PISA results are not great, and we need to work on improving that, but let's not exaggerate the problems our schools face. We all want Scotland to be one of the best places in the world for all types of education. Our universities clearly are world class, so let's work together to ensure our schools are too. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Mason. I now call Jamie Green to be followed by Bill Kidd. Mr. Green.
Thank you. Much of what I have to say today really does depress me, because it's been 3 years since I sat at first on the front bench here in the education brief. And it really depresses me, because what we've heard discussed about the PISA rankings this week made for dire reading to those who really care about Scottish education. Not those who dismissed the findings as simply not as bad as it could be, or even worse, who questioned the league tables themselves. And I say to Mr. McPherson, league tables matter. They really do. Because whichever way you spin it, It made for grim reading. It made for grim reading. Let me finish. Every commentator worth their weight in academic salt has agreed with this. It made for utterly grim reading, because the only rose-tinted glasses that I see in this whole debate are sitting in the middle benches of this chamber, as is evident by the speeches, as is evident by the amendment, and as is evident by their reaction to the PISA results. I have to say, a reaction which was as quick as it was as desperate yesterday. Because Minister Gilroof took to the airwaves as quickly as she could to launch her own counter-PISA defensive, which was seen to ward off all critique and criticism. Yet, this annual report is next to useless, said the academics in response. And that's a phrase, I think, which will surely haunt Ms Gilroof. If the government is keen to talk about results and reports, let's do that. Let's talk about the metrics which really matter. PISA matters. Why? Because it compares Scotland not just to the rest of the UK, but to the rest of the world. And here's what it tells us. It tells us that the OECD average score for maths is 472. The UK-wide score is 489. Scotland sits at 471. Lower than Poland, lower than Switzerland, lower than Ireland. The OECD science average is 485. Scotland's at 483, way below the UK average of 500 and depressingly below comparative nations such as Denmark and Sweden. And it's not a one-off trend. It's a long-term trend. And that is what concerns me most. And here's why it also matters. Because SNP members like to spend much of their time in this chamber lamenting about a global connected Scotland competing in Europe and competing on the international stage, yet be perfectly comfortable with the fact that we trail behind so many of those countries with the very skills that make us competitive in the first place. The story is not much better on reading, as we've heard, and I do wonder what would the great figures of the Scottish Enlightenment make of today's dismal rhetoric from SNP ministers in response. Because every SNP manifesto since 2007 promised to close the attainment gap. Not narrow it, close it. So the statistics which really matter are the academic results themselves, the SQA results. Why? Because they actually compare pass rates across our communities. In 2023, one in four pupils from the most deprived areas achieved an A grade at their NAT5s. That compares to one in two pupils in neighbouring areas. Just think about that for a second. 13% of pupils in our most deprived communities got a no-grade award at NAT5. That compares to 5.7% from those in our least deprived communities. That's identical to the statistics we read in 2019. We have made no progress on this whatsoever. 5 years ago, the gap between our least and most deprived pupils achieving a pass rate in their NAT5s was 17%. That was the established attainment gap. By this year, that gap had shrunk, to credit to the government, but it shrunk to 15.6%. So if the government thinks that 1.4% reduction in the attainment gap over five whole years is something to celebrate, they are clearly deluded, presiding officer. At the current rate, it will take 56 years to close the attainment gap. That is not a record to be proud of. And why is all of this the case? Because the answer lies in a litany of broken pledges, warnings ignored, and an educational ecosystem which has gaping fault lines in it. We all know this already. The class size promise, broken. The teacher number promise, broken. The flagship education bill, ditched. The SQA reform pledge, ditched. The CFE reform pledge, broken. Report after review after task force. The Donaldson report, the Cameron, Bloomer, McCormack reviews, all good reports and all had answers, all sitting on the shelves of numerous education secretaries, the majority of which were too embarrassed to show face today at this debate. Here's where I want to close, though, presiding officer, because the improvements that we see in our schools today are happening not because of the actions of this government, but in spite of them. And no amount of ministerial whataboutery can mask one simple truth, that too many parents and teachers have simply lost trust in the system. And the fault of that lies squarely at the feet of this government and this government and no one else.
Thank you, Mr Green. I now call Bill Kidd to be followed by Paul O'Kane. Mr Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. As we've heard, the recent PISA report comes on the back of the global COVID-19 pandemic, which I'm not finished yet, so hold on. which saw unprecedented disruption across society, including to the provision of education. And for context to today's debate, I hope we'd all agree this has undoubtedly impacted on Scotland's PISA results. It's not to say that we do not agree with or recognise the challenges which we face as set out in the Conservative motion. However, for context, I would have hoped for a recognition of the unique set of circumstances we've all faced. The OECD, the OECD even described this edition of PISA as the COVID edition, saying that there had been an unprecedented drop in attainment globally, with mean performance in OECD countries down 11 points in reading and almost 16 in maths, equivalent to three quarters of a year's worth of learning.
Brian Whittle.
Grateful to Bill Kidd for giving way. Would at least accept, though, that during COVID, the COVID years, Scottish performance in PISA has dropped remarkably quicker than the rest of the United Kingdom under the same circumstances. That has to be levelled at the Scottish Government.
Yeah. Bill Kidd.
Well, let's put it this way. As I said, the OECD described it as the COVID edition, saying an unprecedented drop in attainment globally. Now, there's variations on that, but that's not as if everybody has been great and Scotland's been terrible. So, for further context, this weekend's report by the centre-right think tank, the Centre for Social Justice, may be of interest to all colleagues here. In their report, the CSGI state that COVID lockdowns had a catastrophic effect on the UK's social fabric, especially for the least well-off, where the gap between the so-called haves and have-nots was blown wide open. Their research shows that during lockdown, calls to a domestic help abuse line rose by 700%. Mental ill health in young people went from 1 in 9 to 1 in 6, and by nearly a quarter amongst the oldest of children. Severe absence from school jumped 134%, and 1.2 million more people went on working age benefits, with 86% more people seeking help for addictions. Alarmingly, they also argued that by 2030, if things remain in this route, more than 1 in 4 5 to 15-year-olds, which may be as many as 2.3 million children, could have a mental disorder. Andy Cook, the chief executive of the Centre for Social Justice, said lockdown policy poured petrol on the fire that had already been there in the most disadvantaged people's lives, and so far no one has offered a plan to match the scale of the issues. What the report shows is that we need far more than discussions on finance redistribution, but a strategy to go after the root causes of poverty, education, work, debt, addiction and family. Now, I'm highlighting this report to stress the connection between inequality, poverty and the challenges these factors create for our young people, both educational and in general life. I think it's also important to acknowledge and recognise, as other members have, achievements where they've been made. Scotland has record numbers of young people going to positive destinations, with 94.3% of 16 to 19-year-olds in Scotland in employment, education and training. Sorry, yes.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful, but on the social inequality piece, does he therefore, like me, bemoan the fact that the Scottish Government has failed so appallingly on the free school lunches implementation?
Bill Kidd.
I don't like to have to say, but if it wasn't for the fact that Westminster has cut our money so much, then we would have been able to deliver everything. And besides which, it was this Government that actually made that commitment. Anyway, last year's achievement of Curriculum for Excellence levels results showed the biggest single year reduction in the attainment gap in primary schools in numeracy and literacy. And this summer, Scotland has the highest ever number of National 5 passes in an exam year since the qualification was introduced in 2014. Higher and advanced higher pass rates were above those seen in pre-pandemic 2019. This data and these facts also help inform us as to the state of Scottish education and this Government's record. In this respect, therefore, it is important to look at the holistic picture rather than an isolated study, which I feel today's motion is in danger of appearing to do. I do not say this is done deliberately or that it paints a misleading picture, as I'm sure colleagues' concerns are well-intentioned. One final point I'd like to highlight that may, presiding officer, also have been unintentionally overlooked, is that publicly much has been made over the comparison in these results between Scotland and England. However, it's worth or even essential to note that England did not meet the PISA standards of reporting result in a sample that was found to be biased in that more higher achieving pupils participated than lower achieving pupils. The OECD estimated that this likely resulted in an upward bias in the reported results of approximately 7 or 8 points. That's an important difference. However, in conclusion, presiding officer, in the spirit of cooperation and in recognition of the challenges we must face and overcome, we must all aim to work tirelessly with our colleagues from all parties to advance a common strategy of tackling the issues highlighted today. Finally, I also hope that in her summing up, the Cabinet Secretary will take the opportunity to acknowledge the words of the Chief Executive of the Centre for Social Justice that any strategy must go after the root causes of poverty, education, work debt, addiction and family if we are to be successful and signal the Government's willingness to work with the Education Committee to achieve the same. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Kidd. I now call Paul O'Kane to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan. Mr O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In his speech at the opening of this Parliament in 1999, Donald Dewar described the story of Scotland with vivid imagery evoking our past, in particular the richness of learning and the value of drawing out ideas. He spoke of the discourse of the Enlightenment, when Glasgow and Edinburgh were a light held to the intellectual life of Europe, a nation of poets and philosophers, of economics and science, of reason and wit, and the foundation of so much of our national life and our national institutions, institutions of which to this day remain integral and command pride. In that speech, he also spoke about the idea, when quoting Burns, that sense and worth ultimately prevail. That was understood by Tom Johnson, setting out the road to building a more equitable education system in Scotland, free of academic selection, where everyone had the chance to learn and get on. It was understood by Harold Wilson's government, who set about with reforming zeal, putting in place that comprehensive education and creating the new universities, broadening horizons for more and more people. And it was, of course, understood by Dewar, who recognised the fundamental importance of an education system here in Scotland as an institution of such importance to the lives of us all. A comprehensive school system powered by exceptional teachers who want the best for young people regardless of their background. Colleges at the heart of learning at every stage of life, providing opportunities to reskill and retrain. Our world-leading universities curing diseases, developing technologies that previously didn't exist, and continuing to lead the discourse on international affairs, powered by people from comprehensive schools across Scotland. Deputy Presiding Officer, governments are custodians of that institution. I'd like to make some progress, if you'll allow me. Governments are custodians of that institution, tasked with protecting it and enhancing it as part of the social contract. Not for it to remain unchanging or unmovable, but to consistently build on its foundations. The immense power of this Parliament has given us huge opportunity to do that. Dewar again, the past is part of us, but today there is a new voice in the land, the voice of a democratic Parliament, a voice to shape Scotland, a voice for the future. For 16 years, this government has had the opportunity to shape Scottish education. To narrow the attainment gap was, as we've heard already, a number one priority. To ensure that the promise we make to all young people, that the only limit is their ambition, could be further realised. Yet where do we stand today? Promises broken and decline normalised. In all three subject areas covered by PISA, the scores of Scottish 15-year-olds declined between 2018 and 2022, a drop of 18 points in mathematics, 11 points in reading, and 7 points in science. And over the whole decade from 2012 to 2022, the Scottish decline was equivalent to about 16 months of schooling in mathematics, 8 months in reading, and 18 months in science. In 2022, higher attainment fell by 13% among the most deprived quintile. This is compared to a 5.9% fall for the least deprived. The SNP have knowingly reverted to a system which fails the poorest pupils, and the poorest 20% have been twice as affected as the richest 20%. Teachers are stretched to breaking point with a lack of support and a lack of resource. Subject choice is narrowing in secondaries, and universities are cutting courses. And it is clear, presiding officer, that this government has no idea how to respond, other than to spin its way through and ignore the need for comprehensive change. What a waste. Deputy Presiding Officer, there is no institution in Scotland that is stronger after 16 years of this SNP government. And that makes me angry. Angry for teachers and support staff being so badly let down. Angry for parents who are worried about the future for their children, particularly those parents of children with additional support needs. But angry most of all for our young people who are missing out on the opportunities that were afforded to so many of us in this chamber. And more warm words from the Cabinet Secretary won't cut it. The time for warm words is over. It is clear that this government cannot fix the problem that it has created. So it is beyond time for change. It is beyond time for us to act upon the countless recommendations that have been made in previous years. I will take Alistair Allen.
Alistair Allen.
I'm grateful for the member giving way, and he began by reciting some examples of how his own party improved education in Scotland. I'm more than happy to acknowledge the verity of those. But can he explain how it is he intends to continue in that tradition by his party committing to the Conservative spending plans for the first 2 years of an incoming Labour government, and how he feels that fits in with that tradition?
Paul O'Kane.
When Labour governments are in power across the United Kingdom, education substantially improves through investment. Yep. That is clear. Yep. Children are lifted out of poverty by the investment that is made, because we will grow the economy. And in growing the economy, we will invest in public services. And let's look at the record of the Labour government here in Scotland, because I outlined some of it in my opening. Schools improved. Things got better. Teachers told us how they felt valued. And parents, crucially, had trust in their local schools. There's been a 10% drop in the confidence in local schools since 2011. What does that say in terms of the Scottish Household Attitudes Survey? So Scottish Labour does believe in an education system which enables our country to reach the potential, equips our young people with the skills they rely on throughout their life, and responds to the needs of employers in building a high-wage, high-skilled economy. A Scotland where sense and worth prevail. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr O'Kane. I now call Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Liz Smith. Ms Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too welcome this debate on our children's and young people's education and the focus on how we can invest in better outcomes for our young people and their future. Presiding Officer, I agree the recent outcome of the PISA results are a matter of concern, and I welcome yesterday's statement from the Cabinet Secretary and her commitment to real terms improvements in Scotland's education system for our young people, their parents and the future of this country. Nevertheless, it is imperative that we avoid examining the PISA results in isolation and consider the inescapable influence that austerity and the pandemic, intensified by the current cost of living crisis driven by the Tories, has had on our youth's educational experience. With that said, as a mother of three teenagers, I have personally witnessed the extraordinary resilience displayed by our young people in navigating these challenges along their educational journey. In the face of adversity, their determination really does stand out. Presiding Officer, yesterday's release of the Achievement of Curriculum for Excellence Levels certainly showcases this remarkable display of resilience, where the proportion of pupils achieving expected levels of literacy and numeracy have reached record highs. I welcome the notable rise in the proportion of primary pupils achieving expected levels in literacy and numeracy, and particularly how the positive trend extends across children from both the most and least deprived areas. Sorry. I trust, Presiding Officer, that everyone in the Chamber today will agree that these achievements by our young people deserve not only acknowledgement, but celebration. Presiding Officer, in the Upper Secondary Education Student Assessment in Scotland, a comparative perspectives report by Professor Stobart, the Curriculum for Excellence is described as a pioneering example of 21st century curriculum reform. This is in stark contrast to the Tories' unfounded perspective of a Curriculum for Excellence that has failed. Furthermore, Scotland's Curriculum for Excellence into the Future report stated that the Curriculum for Excellence continues to be a bold and widely supportive initiative, and its design offers the flexibility needed to improve student learning further, once again contradicting the notion of a failed Curriculum for Excellence. In response to the recommendations for review and improvements made by the OECD in this report, I welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to an ambitious process of education reform, which included Let's Talk Scottish Education. This was the biggest public engagement exercise in education to be undertaken nationally in Scotland and ensures that learners' needs and experiences continue to be at the forefront of reform, shaping a future Scottish education that truly empowers and serves our young people. Scotland has indeed made commendable strides in narrowing the attainment gap, and the continuous efforts in education reform aim to enhance this positive trajectory. However, we must acknowledge the harsh reality of the increasing number of families grappling with unimaginable financial hardships. Consequently, due to stress induced by poverty, a growing proportion of children and young individuals are forced to spend their education days grappling with anxieties, fatigue and hunger, instead of enjoying the opportunities for learning and play. Presiding Officer, how can we expect our youth to fully engage in education under these circumstances? Nevertheless, within its limited power, the Scottish Government is advancing efforts to prevent poverty from hindering the education of our children and young people. Notably, this progress encompasses initiatives like the Transformative Scottish Child Payment, which has supported 43,885 children across Lanarkshire, an investment of £62.5 million. Additionally, there is the provision of the most generous, cultivating positive family relationships, enhancing emotional health and wellbeing, and consequently promoting active participation in the school day. To quote Bernardo's, if we uplift these children and families out of poverty, get them the right access to support and mental health, then surely we can help children be ready in the class to learn. Presiding Officer, I completely agree. A few final points in closing. Michael Mara and others believe the PISA results are worth a moan. But using PISA as a stick to beat education with and basically rubbishing the Scottish education system in its entirety is unfair and unhelpful. It undermines the teachers and staff working so hard to support wellbeing, and it undermines the achievements of our children and young people that go way beyond academic scores and exams. So let's be mindful of how political point scoring can impact our schools and prioritise our young people's needs. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Callaghan. And I now call Liz Smith to be followed by Kate Forbes. Ms Smith.
Thank you. This is my 19th debate on school standards, taking me through the eras of Fiona Hislop, Mike Russell, Angela Constance, John Swinney, Shirley Ann Somerville, and now Jenny Gilruth, who I see has gone out of the class just like the rest of them. Jenny Gilruth was, of course, a teacher, and that's a big plus mark as far as I'm concerned, and she served on the Education Committee for a short time in 2016 and then again 2018-20, when the question of school standards was never far from the agenda. And that was largely because Nicola Sturgeon had told the education leaders, unequivocally I may say, that education was her number one priority and that there would be a new education bill. Now, John Swinney followed that up by telling us, and I quote, the status quo was not an option. No one disagreed. And looking back at the Education Committee's deliberation, there was plenty of evidence as to why. Jamie Green, in fact, has just reminded us that we should consider if we would actually really be here again debating school standards if the Scottish Government had both listened to and acted upon the collective findings of the Donaldson, McCormack, Cameron and Bloomer reviews into Scottish school education, commissioned, I may say, by the Scottish Government and all carried out by experts in their respective fields between 2011 and 2016. Because the collective message then was that while Scottish education had much upon which to pride itself, the school system had to be shaken out of its complacency. How true that was. Of course, these reports between 2011 and 2016 appeared when there were other warning signs, at the very time when the OECD, the Scottish Survey of Attainment, PISA, Reform Scotland, but also the Scottish Government's own statistics all produced compelling evidence that Scotland was flatlining, and worse still, that the attainment gap between rich and poor was widening, thereby disadvantaging a whole cohort of young people. And that's something which has been absolutely fundamentally at odds with the basic principles of a good Scottish education, once renowned across the world. And I think we should remind ourselves of why Scotland's education was previously so good. because the curriculum was so well founded on systematic knowledge, including for weaker pupils, because primary school education placed such a considerable importance on every child being able to read, write and count properly, and also on working hard and respecting the teacher, because teachers were highly valued by parents and well-grounded in their own subject disciplines, and because we took great pride in the pursuit of excellence. That is exactly how it should be today. And, Presiding Officer, there is absolutely nothing, nothing at all, that is inconsistent between that and the original principles of a curriculum for excellence. That's why it won cross-party support and why it was so warmly welcomed by many international observers. The problem was, and remains, its implementation. With hindsight, and I think Peter Peacock would agree with this, the title Curriculum for Excellence was actually a misnomer. It was not designed at all to be a new curriculum. It was designed to be a new methodology of teaching. And it's about this that so many questions have arisen. Several barriers have been put in the way of the pursuit of excellence, barriers which have meant that teachers' attention has all too often taken them away from their central role of teaching. As a result, frustration has set in and it has affected pupils' self-discipline in far too many cases. That needs to change, and I admire Jenny Gilruth for her willingness to tackle that indiscipline, but that needs to be accompanied by a system that inspires and delivers high standards. And that is not the case just now. We need to free up our teachers, including those who do so much for our pupils with additional support needs, many of whom with genuine learning issues get labelled as badly behaved when they're not, and they have to exist in classes where there is no one-to-one attention. Secondly, the Scottish Government really does need to properly reform the education agencies, not just rebadge them and move the deck chairs around a bit, but properly reform them to enhance the support that is available to teachers, because that, again, has not happened. But thirdly, and I come to the point that was raised by my colleague Brian Whittle, we must ask ourselves, what is education for? Because we need to consider the intrinsic value of education. We need to stand back and ask ourselves from a holistic perspective what we are asking our schools to do. And for me, that has to include the quality provision of extracurricular, or perhaps it's better named as co-curricular activity. Because as well as successful learners, the curriculum for excellence is supposed to be about nurturing confident individuals and responsible citizens. And we should never forget that for many pupils, the co-curriculum is the most enriching part of their school career. But just because it can't be easily measured, the agencies have never wanted to know about it. That is to the great detriment of Scottish education. Presiding Officer, I'm going to finish on one very important point. I fundamentally believe that Scottish education has the ability to be the best in the world again. But it is only if we recognise what the problem is and accept that we have to do an awful lot more to achieve that ambition.
Yes. Thank you, Ms Smith. And I now call Kate Forbes. Ms Forbes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Anybody who is related to a teacher, as I am, or has kids in school, as I do, knows that the impact of the last few years has been monumental on them. And I think they deserve our great thanks, and hopefully that's a point of consensus that we can all settle on. But perhaps the most effective show of gratitude is indeed to get our next steps on education right. And I certainly fear that overly politicised debates often miss the wood for the trees, although there have been some excellent contributions this afternoon. I also have great confidence in the Cabinet Secretary as a former teacher with an extensive network, I am sure, of former colleagues to get it right. Because there is no public service as critical as education, in my opinion. Good quality education that equips our young people with the skills, the knowledge, the ability to thrive and prosper is the most important duty on any society to give our young people. But its success must be measured in outcomes, not obsessive debates about inputs. And I want to talk this afternoon about two of the most critical outcomes as I see it. I could talk, I'm sure, of many more, but I'm going to restrict my remarks to two. The first is this. In our globalised world, our young people must thrive and prosper relative to their peers in countries around the world. There are plenty of questions about how helpful PISA results are, and surely we can all agree that they don't tell us the full story. But they do tell us something, and that something needs to be acknowledged. Because I want Scotland to flourish and prosper and outperform other nations, to have lower poverty, a more thriving economy, and to lead the way on true equality. And all of that relies fully and completely on a good education system. We'll all speak to parents and teachers, many of whom can point to great successes in our education system. I'm consistently impressed whenever I visit a school. I'm consistently impressed by their young people's knowledge, the breadth of education, the focus on values. I saw that today when speaking to Dingwall Academy in the Parliament. But equally, we've all heard qualitative evidence by young people, by parents, by teachers themselves, about ways that Scotland's education system does need reform. And I think the First Minister noted that last week, and the Cabinet Secretary has rightly acknowledged that today. Literacy and numeracy, skills and knowledge really matter. One parent told me with some concern that her daughter had just left sixth year never having studied algebra. She's never owned a scientific calculator. Now, I was never a fan of algebra, so I'm probably slightly jealous. But equally, that is a pretty critical element of a rounded education system. And Liz Smith talked about aims. I was going to talk about clarifying the aim of our education system here this afternoon. I think if we really boil it down, the question of aims is a very contested conversation. Education Scotland says it aims to equip young people with knowledge, confidence and skills. And what does it then say? Giving them a competitive edge in a global job market. And so all the comparisons that we've heard this afternoon with a previous golden age is, in my view, nonsense. I imagine most of us were educated during that so-called golden age, and that might be all the evidence that we need, that it wasn't golden. What really matters is the modern-day international comparison. Yes.
Elizabeth?
I'm grateful. Interesting comments that Kate Forbes is making. Does she agree, however, that in the Scottish education system of the generation that she is talking about, the ability not only to impart knowledge was also able to inculcate the rounded individual that has made Scotland what it was? Does she not think that that's important in the current system?
Kate Forbes?
I think Liz Smith made some really excellent points in her remarks, and I also think that we should look back at how we can reform the current system to echo the previous system, whilst also accepting it wasn't perfect. And I suppose, just as an aside, I am somebody who was educated 20 years ago or so, not just within the Scottish state system, but also across different countries' systems. And I can certainly point to the fact it wasn't perfect 20 years ago. But secondly, my second outcome is that this aim must be true for all children, irrespective of whether they grow up in the most or least deprived communities in Scotland. The attainment gap is, of course, measured by educational outcomes, but we need to be clear that it's non-educational issues that are denying our young people equal opportunities. Poverty, trauma, hunger, family instability, homelessness. There is no fix to the attainment gap without comprehensive support to families, households, and wise economic interventions. And that burden cannot fall to teachers alone. It just cannot. And to expect teachers to shoulder the responsibility for all of that is completely unfair. They already have the essential role for educating, teaching, equipping our young people, to push them, to give them a sense of ambition and aspiration, to ensure they believe in themselves and that they can achieve whatever they wish. That is a full-time job in itself. And one of the things that exercises me the most is when politicians, including those in the chamber and others outside the chamber, suggest that education or schools should fix all of society's woes. They cannot single-handedly. And so, Presiding Officer, my second constructive point is this. I'd like to see much better integration of services to support our young people and families more generally, to allow teachers to be free to teach and to free our young people to learn. And so, in conclusion, the world has changed, and so must education. To hang all of our analysis solely on PISA results is short-sighted, but it does confirm that the Cabinet Secretary and others are right to talk about reform, but the success or otherwise of this debate must be measured in outcomes, not in inputs, but the success will determine the opportunities for our young people on an international basis, and the importance cannot be underestimated.
Thank you, Ms Forbes. And we will now move to closing speeches, and I call on Martin Whitfield to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it is, as always, a pleasure to participate in the debates in this chamber, particularly with regard to education and what a crucial time we find ourselves in. I would like to start, and I make no bones about this, of quoting a journalist, Barry Black from The Scotsman on the 24th of November. Teacher and scientist Carl Sagan, he quotes, once said, "It is better the hard truth than the comforting fantasy." And there can't be any group of people in more need of hard truths than policymakers in Scottish education. There is a comforting fantasy, continually rehearsed by those at the top, that progress is being made on education equality in Scotland, that the gap in results between the richest and poorest pupils is closing. The hard truth is simply that it is not. He goes on to criticise not just the Scottish Government, but all politicians who hide behind this fantasy. And I think there have been a significant number of contributions in this debate this afternoon that have pointed to the very same thing. I made mention to the Cabinet Secretary about the PISA comment in the amendment that lodged. And the only element that the Scottish Government could find to quote in its amendment is that the PISA found the pupils in Scotland were less likely to witness issues with a number of aspects of behaviour in school than in other parts of the UK. And yet across the chamber, we heard a call for us to come together across this chamber and recognise not just the challenges, but also the benefits, also the good points. The difficulty is that that responsibility rests most forcibly with the Scottish Government, because you are the people that our teachers, that our directors of education, that our local authorities, that our third sector, that our charities look up to. And you are the people who have the responsibility to our young people to deliver on this. There have been many powerful and interesting contributions. Indeed, the Cabinet Secretary spoke about the changes that are bringing in and the review, first of all, in maths. I would say it's interesting that maths and literacy has been highlighted when, as we came out of COVID, health and well-being was trumpeted as the most important area, rightly so. But we have still heard of the challenging mental health problems that face our young people and, indeed, those that surround them. And, again, much as ASN pupils were omitted from the discussion yesterday, so is health and well-being. And yet we've heard today the importance of the co-curricula, the physical education, the sports clubs, the associations, the things that our young people participate outside of school and through school that actually makes a quality of life, that leads them to be happy, to lead them to have fun, and for some of our young people to have areas where they can excel, whereas in some of our other areas, they can't. But we look to maths, but we still need the question is, what are we going to look at? Are we going to look at what's being taught? Are we going to look at how maths is being taught? Are we going to look at the sequencing that maths is acquired by? We heard about the logical steps of curriculum in the past in Scotland. They're the details that we need. They're the details that I think our teachers, our young people, parents, and the people of Scotland are saying, rather than another review that goes round the houses, because the Cabinet Secretary is aware that there is substantial work across Scotland about how maths can be taught successfully, both to children that are challenged by maths in high school, but earlier on. We can identify that if these steps are missed, if these building blocks don't exist in P1, P2, P3, P4, P5, P6 and P7, they are going to be challenged in maths. Why can't we build on that? Why can't we accept that? Why can't we take it out? Because it carries with it pedagogical value. I want to make mention of Willie Rennie's comment, because the report did yesterday and the Scottish Government have indicated that it appears that through their stretch aims, we're only looking at a 30% reduction. And I hope there's an opportunity either to say there will be other strategies brought forward to narrow the remaining 70%, or is it in fact that we're settling that a 30% improvement in the attainment gap will be sufficient. I want to make mention of Michelle Thompson's comments because I think particularly, I think we can argue about the value of PISA and any set of data can be challenged on how it is good. But I think that your comments about the need for communication support, particularly in the early years, is incredibly valid. I think we should all be aware of the challenges that our young people are facing in and as a result of COVID and that isolation, that their communication levels and strategies aren't at what was expected, which makes teaching them a challenge, particularly as they move up through primary education. I think that was a very powerful contribution. And to Ben McPherson, his discussion about positive destinations, which were raised by others, I think one of the challenges we have here is that simply it's measured for 3 months. We are outside measuring the positive destination of the children that left in summer. If they worked in a charity shop, they had one. If that's closed, they don't anymore. So on the acquisition of data, we need to follow this much further. I recognise that time is tight, and there are a number of things that I wanted to make. I think Brian Whittle's contribution was very, very powerful and has been echoed that the expectation that somehow our schools can solve all these problems is wrong. But the solution going forward for our young people is education. So I'll just finish by quoting my colleague Michael Mara and simply say, how many wake-up calls do we need? I'm grateful.
Thank you, Mr Whitfield. And I now call on Jenny Gilruth to close on behalf of the Scottish Government. Up to 7 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was reading a piece by the journalist David Leask over the weekend who spoke of that perceived golden age in Scottish education that I think Kate Forbes mentioned and who queried whether or not that was ever the case. And I think it is worth Parliament reflecting that for generations of young Scots, school education was far from inclusive. It was for the academic, and for the rest, they were sent elsewhere, encouraged to leave. School was not for them. I listened yesterday morning to a head teacher in North Lanarkshire on the radio, describing the shift in school education throughout the course of her 30-year teaching career. And she said, when I started teaching, it was very much about the academic side. Once children come in the doors, they become school pupils. Once they leave, they go home. And there was a bit of detachment. But now you want the community to be involved. We offer a drop-in on a Wednesday, a parent and toddler group on a Friday. It's about making sure those doors are always open. That inclusivity of Scotland's education system was a key theme which emerged from the recent national discussion on Scotland's education system. A strength in our offer, unique to our approach. Now, as I set out yesterday in my statement to Parliament, a knee-jerk political response to the challenges we face in Scottish education is not going to help our young people. We need to work together with our teachers while recognising the pressure that they are under to determine and to agree how best we can deliver on the improvements that we all want to see. Now, I want to respond to some of the points that have been raised by members throughout the course of what I think has been, in the main, quite a positive and helpful debate in relation to educational improvement. And I certainly welcome the commitment from many members to engage constructively with the government for that pragmatic route forward. Now, in relation to the ASIL data, Mr Rennie, who I know is no longer in the chamber, but he talked about the PISA data.
Cabinet Secretary, could you please resume your seat for a second? Thank you. I just want to say that I'm well aware why Mr Rennie is not in the chamber, unlike perhaps the Cabinet Secretary. Thank you.
Apologies, Presiding Officer, I am, and I've spoken to Mr Rennie, but I did want to mention that I wanted to respond to his point, as we discussed earlier privately. He mentioned the importance of the PISA data, and I again draw Parliament's attention to the ASIL data, which are, of course, official statistics. Those are based on teacher professional judgments, and I very much trust our teachers to make those accurate assessments about our children's progress, and I hope that members will agree with that sentiment. Mr Rennie also talked about co-production of support materials for our classroom teachers, and I agree with that sentiment. I think there's opportunity through educational reform to look again at how we support the profession at the chalk face. I also agree with the assertion Mr Rennie made around about curriculum for excellence and some of the way in which that curriculum development or change was implemented. I think that was also raised by Brian Whittle, actually. He might know that I was in the classroom at that time. And I think there are ways, and I reflect on that now as a Cabinet Secretary in this government, that we can improve that in the future. And I hope Parliament hears that some of my apprehension around where we've got to on reform is that we don't repeat the mistakes of the past. It's important that when we drive forward those changes,
We do it at a pace with the teaching profession and one which supports them. So to Mr Rennie's point, which I thought was actually a really salient one, teachers are not second-guessing where the changes in the curriculum are going to happen. And as a case in point, I spoke very recently, Presiding Officer, to the Scottish Association of Geography Teachers, who gave me a really good explanation about some of the changes they could bring forward in their suite of qualifications. I think that's why we need to trust teachers in driving the reform improvements we need to see. And that's exactly why yesterday, of course, I gave the commitment to Parliament that we will appoint a maths specialist to lead on improvements to the maths curriculum. Happy to do so.
I'm very grateful. The Cabinet Secretary might not know this, but after some very difficult and contentious reforms taken by the Conservative government, England's maths ranking in PISA went from 27th place in 2009, 17th in 2014, and now it's 11th, which is a considerable improvement. Will the Cabinet Secretary be engaging positively with our counterpart in Westminster to achieve the same thing?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Kerr for his intervention. I'm well aware of England's rankings. He will also be aware of where England are in terms of their approach to curriculum content and how they deliver education in England, which in my experience is a bit more prescriptive than that which we have in Scotland. However, I'm more than happy to engage with my Conservative counterpart, Ms Keegan. I haven't yet met with her. She wasn't massively keen to engage with me, I should say, in relation to the recent RAC issue that we experienced. However, more than happy to engage with Ms Keegan. My door is always open, as he knows. Now, I want to pick up some of the comments raised by other members throughout the course of the debate. Michelle Thompson spoke about some of the challenge with PISA and the sampling discrepancies which can arise. She also mentioned the division between rich and poor countries, which I thought was an interesting point historically to consider and to change actually the way in which we view education. The point she made in relation to speech and language was well made. I'll come back to that point, as I know it was made by another member. She raised the importance of excellence, and I think the new Centre for Teaching Excellence, to my mind, will play a key role, Presiding Officer, in driving some of the improvement we need to see. I'm conscious of time, Presiding Officer, so in the interest of time, I'll move quickly on to catch a few points that have been made by a number of other colleagues. Mr McPherson made an impressive contribution and he spoke about the record numbers of our young people who are now going on to positive destinations. I think that is welcome progress, Presiding Officer. He's also right to talk about the danger of teaching to the test, which is a point I was making in response to Mr Kerr there, in relation to the approach we take with pedagogy and any potential shift towards that, I think would be one we would want to guard against. Now, Brian Whittle's point about getting education wrong and every portfolio suffers is a live point to me, considering we're obviously engaged in budget negotiations at the current time. I think he's absolutely right. And I think the point that Kate Forbes made about joining up services needs to perhaps be better reflected in how we future-proof our budgeting in Scottish Government, recognising that the education budget can't do all the heavy lifting. We need those partners to come in and to plug the gaps where actually school education can't be expected to do so necessarily. John Mason spoke about education in his day, and I can't imagine actually ever having been a teacher being paid to hit a child. But in my lifetime, Presiding Officer, that happened in Scotland schools. We have come a long way in the last 40 years. But I recognise the challenge today in relation to behaviour, and that's why, of course, I set out to Parliament a number of weeks ago the action plan we will be taking forward with our local authority partners in relation to the issues associated with behaviour. Presiding Officer, I'm very conscious of time, so I will, unless there is time in hand, move to summing up. I think Scotland has a strong education system. That does not mean I am accepting of the need for improvements, far from it. But I do invite the opposition today to reflect on the role that they can play in building that better future for Scotland's children and young people. My view, Presiding Officer, is that the Chamber is Scotland's classroom. If you want better behaviour, let's start here. If you want more attentive pupils, then let's have more attentive MSPs. If you want to stop the corrosive impact of misogyny in our schools, then consider who you follow on social media, what you share, and how you engage with female politicians, irrespective of party. Because what we do in this place matters. And if, as I think we heard yesterday and to some extent today, there is consensus for improvement in our education system, then I will work with any and every party in this place to do exactly that. Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I now call on Ros McCall to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 9 minutes, please, Ms McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be closing the debate this afternoon, and I would like to highlight some of the contributions that have been made across the Chamber. And I've got a lot, so I'll do my best to get around to everybody. I want to highlight first and foremost the remarks that have been made by the Cabinet Secretary, Martin Whitfield, Liz Smith, Willie Rennie and Pam Duncan-Glancy when they are regarding the teaching profession. They deserve all our respect and I echo those comments. I also note that the ASIL figures were mentioned by the Cabinet Secretary, Martin Whitfield, Michelle Thompson and Willie Rennie. And I also note that Liam Kerr had made a comment regarding Professor Patterson's quote that putting the ASIL comment, figures above PISA would be either disingenuous or evidence of dismaying statistical ignorance. And I think it is important to restate that. I will.
Cabinet Secretary.
I accept the point the member is making, and she quotes, of course, Lindsay Patterson. I just want to reiterate that we will not be putting any data set above another. It's important, though, that we look at the data set in the round, and I hope the member accepts that. The ASIL data is predicated on teacher judgment. We trust Scotland's teachers every year to mark our exams, to set the national standard and to set the examination papers themselves. So I hope the Conservatives do trust Scotland's teachers' judgment in relation to the ASIL data.
Ros McCall.
I do accept that, and I'll have other comments later on which will hopefully address that, because I would like to get on a little bit. But I also accept that COVID and the fact that these were the COVID PISA scores that was highlighted by Michelle Thompson, by Bill Kidd, by the Cabinet Secretary, by Ben McPherson, by Brian Whittle and by Michael Mara. And I thought it was interesting that there was an absolute split in the debate as to how fundamental this was to the PISA scores and any failing results, and I think that should also be highlighted. I also note that we have to move on from COVID excuses. It is incumbent on the Scottish Government to see where Scottish policies are failing and to use its powers to move past COVID. And if we're on a trajectory and that was highlighted by COVID and has been halted by COVID, then we have to do more to get round it. I want to
take an
I will, thank you.
Liam Kerr.
Just on that exact point, Michelle Thompson brought up Andreas Schleicher, and Andreas Schleicher was very clear that attainment was declining in Scotland long before COVID. Does the member not recognise that?
Ros McCall.
I do recognise that. I'll happily jump forward on some of my notes to actually, one regarding Michelle Thompson's comment. We're actually to look at long-term trends, and I think if we do look at the long-term trends, we find that the trajectory is downwards, and it was long before COVID that that happened. I comment on Pam Duncan-Glancy, who talked about long-standing systemic problems not addressed for years, and that the decline must be reversed, and that teachers are under immense pressure and classroom sizes are still too large, and I don't think anyone can argue with that. I also really want to comment on Sue Webber, my colleague, regarding mobile phones, that has the greatest negative impact. I do wonder that if the promise of a device for everyone in Scotland's schools had actually come to fruition, that would also give head teachers the opportunity to ensure that online work was monitored through that device, and it would also give them that possibility to ban mobile phones within the classroom, and I certainly think we should be looking at pushing that forward. I do accept Ben McPherson's comment that it is right for us to scrutinise. I don't think it's only right, I think it's essential, especially when the education of Scots, young Scots are on the line. Brian Whittle made a comment regarding the cornerstone of every policy in this place is through education. I think it's a perfect quote as well, highlighting the importance that it's not good enough to raise the rest of the world if the rest, sorry, raise up if the rest of the world raises faster and better. And I also want to comment that Liz Smith has made excellent comments regarding how we need to free up our teachers and remove the barriers to actually let them teach. And I agree wholeheartedly that Scottish education has the potential to be the best in the world, and that is something I think we should all recognise. Presiding Officer, in preparing my notes ahead of this debate, I had hoped to be more consensual. For example, the full and frank way the Cabinet Secretary acknowledged the challenges raised in the PISA report yesterday was certainly welcome. It was her tone when calling for cross-party work for the good of Scotland's young people. Scottish Conservatives will always welcome any moves to drive improvement across school education, and I look forward to debating education reform in the new year. However, I'm afraid that it was the former First Minister who asked us and Scotland to judge her on her government's record on education. The former First Minister also said that she had a sacred responsibility to provide equal opportunities to all children. When these statements were made, the Scottish Government were full of ideas and guidelines that it would put in place to empower local authorities. The Government took complete ownership of education for all Scotland's young people, and it's more than disappointing to see some abdication of that ownership, and I hope that that is only temporary. The SNP's record speaks for itself and it has been rehearsed this afternoon. The SNP government have presided over 16 years of failure in education, with the latest PISA study confirming Scotland has fallen to record low levels in maths, reading and science internationally. The SNP have starved schools and staff of resources, and the implementation of their curriculum of excellence has been an unmitigated disaster. As Scottish Conservatives, we know that education is one of the routes out of poverty, because through a thorough education based on knowledge, facts, fundamental basics of reading, writing and counting, respect for teachers and fellow pupils is a surefire way to change lives. As much as I know that the debate has moved on, it would be remiss of me not to return to some of the issues that need addressing as a matter of urgency. Bullying and violence. I've mentioned this before in questions to the Cabinet Secretary, but we simply cannot raise the issue and wait for a plan when it comes to discipline in the classroom. The current process across Scotland simply puts any consequences for bullying and violence within a classroom setting onto the victim. Bullied young people are the ones who have to alter their behaviour or move away from their friends to another seat or even class. Teachers are powerless to halt any violent or aggressive attack on pupils or even themselves. And with the OECD report finding that bullying in Scottish schools is more frequent than the OECD average, that one in three of our students don't feel safe in schools, and that pupils in Scotland are twice as likely to observe violence in school, then a real sense of urgency is required now, and any delay is unacceptable. International standings. My question to the Cabinet Secretary on this topic was yesterday. I note the comments that PISA has a specific process measuring 15-year-olds' ability to use their skills in reading, maths and science to meet real-life challenges. But given that's the only international benchmark we take part in, it's therefore the only league table we can currently use to see how well Scotland is faring internationally. It's also important to note that all the other countries that take part in this are monitored on the same criteria. So it's relevant to see just as well how well Scottish 15-year-olds fare in comparison to other countries in the application of that knowledge. Using our own internal processes is simply not enough to ensure we're providing an education that will open doors and opportunities across the globe. And it's disappointing that we do have to wait until 2026 for TIMSS and PIRLS international league tables so we can properly assess our education system and make sure it's fit for purpose globally. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we need a comprehensive vision for education here in Scotland that I don't think we currently have. A vision where every granny can look at the school her grandchildren attend and know that they'll be in an informed learning environment where they will be engaged and empowered. Learning about subjects that will not only allow them to go on to a job, a college, a university or a positive destination, but help them in a world where they will always need to balance money at the end of the month. A world where communication skills of grammar and punctuation are more necessary than ever before. And language is essential for proper understanding. A world where information is filtered through AI algorithms, so research and problem-solving skills are paramount to ensure the truth is not masked behind opinion. They need to know that their grandchildren are safe when they're in a classroom and school grounds, and that consequences are there for misbehaviour. That boundaries are in place so that the few are not disrupting the chances of the many. They need to know that arts and sports have just as much importance as modern languages and calculus for a well-balanced body, mind and soul, and that learning home economics is a skill that will help them through every walk of life. Until we have that vision, Presiding Officer, we are failing. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. McCall. That concludes the debate on improving the performance of the Scottish education system, and it is now time to move on to the next item of business. And the next item of business is consideration of business motion 11651 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. I call on George Adam Minister to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Douglas Ross to speak to and move Amendment 11651.1. Mr Ross.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I speak tonight to seek an addition into next week's business to deliver something that the SNP Green Government promised to do, a statement by the end of the year on the duelling of the A9. Now, I'm standing here trying to be helpful to the business manager and to Parliament. And SNP MSPs may try to ridicule that, but I'm simply trying to get something inserted into the business that they themselves promise. That's why we are moving this amendment to have that statement next week. Now, the most recent promise for this government was to provide a statement by the end of the year, but in the business motion just moved by George Adam, taking us up to the Christmas recess and therefore the last opportunity this calendar year, there is no mention at all on that promise statement for duelling the A9. Now, I don't think it should be up to opposition parties to use parliamentary process to force the government's hand, but if they are unwilling to do so, then we must. And let's just look at the history of this. In June, 6 months ago, the government was planning to update this parliament on the A9 project. They got one of their backbench MSPs, Jim Fairley, to submit a government-inspired question. That is used to announce to Parliament and the public a project or announcement that is ready to go. And then it got withdrawn, something we believe it has never happened in this Parliament before. Now, I questioned the First Minister on this on the 15th of June, and he told the Chamber that the reason it was withdrawn was because we had a new Transport Minister, and she needed time to look at the project. Now, she's had several months to look at that, and now we're told she won't even be making this announcement and this statement. It will actually be the Cabinet Secretary. But the First Minister told me it is very important, the A9, and when we are ready to update Parliament with an announcement on the A9, we will absolutely do that. But they were ready to update Parliament back in June when they had that government-inspired question. Now, the First Minister went on to say, and this is a quote, "We will ensure, of course, that any update we provide in a statement to Parliament is accurate." So let's just hope the former Transport Minister, Michael Matheson, isn't involved if we're looking for accuracy. But after that, we then had the Cabinet Secretary for Transport telling us that the update would come, and this is a quote, "by the end of autumn and before the start of winter." Well, autumn has been and gone, as has the start of winter, and yet there's still no update to MSPs and the constituents we represent. Earlier this afternoon, the SNP business manager, in response to my colleague Edward Mountain, told the Chamber that the government expects to update the Parliament on the renewed programme in the coming days. So why have they asked this Parliament tonight to vote for a business statement that does not include a statement on the A9? If it's coming in the coming days, why is it not in our statement that we are being asked to support tonight? There have been repeated promises made to the communities for which this road is crucial that have failed to materialise from the SNP government. There has been very little action on this vital road for communities from Perth to Inverness, and that is why it is so important. It is crucial that we hear the statement in Parliament before the end of the year. Now, Scottish Conservative research has shown that it may take, at the current pace, over a century to complete the duelling of the A9 between Perth and Inverness. It cannot, it must not take that long. So we need to know in a statement what the next steps are, when the spades will be in the ground and when the duelling will be complete. Now, we have repeatedly tried to get a statement in this Parliament. When we were told it would be by the end of autumn, we asked on the last day of autumn for a statement. We asked again 2 weeks ago. We asked again yesterday. And indeed, at the Bureau yesterday, my colleague Alex Burnett, our party's business manager, was told there was a Cabinet process to follow. I mean, just exactly how long does that Cabinet process take? We still have no statement, and Parliament deserves the opportunity to scrutinise the government's plans on this. Now, I am hopeful, in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, that George Adam is just about to stand up and say he and the government accept our amendment tonight, that a statement will be included next week to deliver on their promises. Now, if he doesn't do that, then the question falls to people like John Swinney, to Richard Lockhead, to Emma Roddick, to Marie Todd, to Jim Fairley, to other representatives, Kate Forbes, whose constituents are expecting an update in this chamber. Surely they will want to vote with the Scottish Conservatives tonight to get that secured in the business for next week, because their constituents expect it.
Thank you, Mr Ross. I now call on George Adam, Minister, to respond on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What we've heard from Mr Ross there is a complete
misunderstanding or just no clue of how parliamentary process works in the Scottish Parliament. And it's extremely disappointing because the whole point of the Parliamentary Bureau, and we all sit there as business managers, is to talk about business and make sure that we get things in a space where we can discuss that and bring things forward. We've heard enough from Mr. Ross at the moment. So it's down to basic respect of this Parliament. And my job as Minister for Parliamentary Business is to ensure that we work within our Parliament's processes. And the Scottish Government remains committed to completing the dualling of the A9 between Perth and Inverness, and we expect to update on a renewed programme in the coming days. Now, I don't understand what the Conservative Party cannot understand about days. You know, that sounds to me as if it's pretty imminent. But when you look at this, as everyone knows, the Scottish Government follows the parliamentary business process. This includes, and I'll explain this for Mr Ross's case because he misunderstood that bit as well, is the exact timing we'll have. It includes the Cabinet approval of the Scottish Government business and then Bureau's consideration of the business programme as a whole before finally approval for Parliament as a whole is sought. So it's about using the processes within this Parliament to ensure that we can do this, not grandstanding here at decision time and actually doing it that way. The founding principles, presiding officer, of this Parliament is for us to all work together to ensure that we deliver for the people of Scotland. And standing there for 5 minutes grandstanding is not part of that. As I said, the Scottish Government remains firmly committed to completing the dualling of the A9 between Perth and Inverness and work to determine the most suitable procurement options for the remaining sections of the A9 dualling is now well advanced and the Parliament will receive an update in the coming days. And I'll repeat that once again, the coming days. We're in full panto zone now with the Conservatives at this point. Once the date for the statement has been scheduled, I will inform Parliament in the usual manner, presiding officer. Can we all just calm down here and allow Parliament to do its job and stop the petty grandstanding?
Thank you, Minister. The question is that Amendment 11651.1 in the name of Douglas Ross, which seeks to amend Business Motion 11651 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a business programme, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed. Therefore, we will move to a vote. There will be a short... I'm sorry? Sorry, I will call the question again. The question is that Amendment 11651.1 in the name of Douglas Ross, which seeks to amend Business Motion 11651 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, and therefore we will move to a vote. There will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system. Thank you.